grateful for our musicians and leading us in worship. We're thankful for Matt. And I do want to say again a special word of appreciation to Matt for filling the pulpit last week in my absence on Wednesday. And he'll also be carrying the load this Wednesday night. I'll be out of town helping my mom. She's still recovering from surgery. And so I'll be gone Monday, come back Friday, and help her hopefully get to where she can start walking around after her surgery. This morning we're going to be in Isaiah chapter 53. Give you a moment to take your Bible and turn there, Isaiah 53. We've been going through the Sermon on the Mount, and that's where we're going to resume after Easter. And we're going to be preparing our hearts for Easter this week, next week, and then of course Easter Sunday. And I've got some unique sermons lined up. Nothing new, obviously, because the Word of God is ever true. But some sermons that maybe give us a different perspective, look at some different details of Easter that maybe we don't look at quite as often. We're all familiar with Isaiah 53. It speaks of the fact that Jesus Christ was pierced for our transgressions. And it speaks of how Jesus took our punishment. And we're going to be talking in detail today about what exactly Jesus did. I've titled the sermon, Jesus, Our Sacrifice, Our Hope. And that's really the main thing I want to tell you today, is that Jesus Christ was our sacrifice, a sacrifice in our place. I want you to understand this morning that what Jesus went through is what you deserve for your sins. But he was our substitute. He took that in our place. It's also our hope, because what he did was not just lay down his life as a sacrifice. He now extends true hope through the gospel to those who would believe. So this morning, I have nothing but good news for you. The work is done. As Jesus said, it is finished. And so there is great news for us to consider this morning. I want to begin reading Isaiah chapter 53, if you're there. We'll start reading in verse 1. The Bible says this, "Who has believed what he has heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not." Verse 4 says, "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." Now, I think all of us in here, at least most of us, are familiar with this passage of Scripture. And we're going to finish the chapter as we go on in the sermon. This morning, I want us to consider that Jesus Christ laid aside his glory for a time. He came to be a sacrifice in our place. Jesus Christ came to do a work that nobody else could do. And part of this work, the first part of this work, is laying aside his glory. I want you to imagine what it would have been like to be Jesus in eternity past. So we're talking the moment where God said, "Let there be light," and there was light in the very beginning of your Bible. Go for billions of years and billions of years before that. And consider the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And there is a plan made up by God within the Trinity to send Jesus Christ to die on the cross and to be the sacrifice for sins of people who were not yet created. We're talking the eternal plan of God. And to think that Jesus Christ has always dwelt in perfection, has always dwelt in glory, and yet he comes down to this earth humbly. He lays aside his glory. He does not become less God. I'm not saying his godhood is diminished. I'm not saying he's less divine. I'm saying he, if you could say this, shrouded his glory in flesh for for a season. Fully God, fully man, eternally God, not created. That is the most basic teachings of Jesus Christ. And he came to earth not to be a celebrity. We have a view of Jesus sometimes that Jesus was popular. Jesus was hated by many. Jesus was not somebody who got all the attention all the time. Look what it says. It says, who has believed what we have heard from us? Who has believed what he has heard from us, excuse me, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? It says he grew up before him like a young plant, like a root out of dry ground. Jesus did not have fertile beginnings, so to speak. He was not born into a privileged household. He did not come from good stock, as we would say. He was an ordinary person, born to an ordinary family, like a root out of dry ground. It says in the second part of verse 2, he had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and he had no beauty that we should desire him. This is speaking of the fact that Jesus, humanly speaking and earthly speaking, was very ordinary. He's not somebody that you would look at and say, I want to follow that man. I remember the commercials. I can't believe it's not butter. He had Fabio, or however you want to say his name. And he was strong and mighty. He had the long, flowing, blonde hair. And you can look at that man and say, that's a strong man. That's not what they saw when they saw Jesus. When they saw Jesus, they saw nothing that made him desirable. His majesty was there, but it was not readily visible. Verse 3 goes on to say that he was despised and rejected by men. He's a man of sorrows. And if you know anything about the life of Jesus, you know he suffered greatly. I'm asking this morning to consider that the first part of this sacrifice is that he had just become one of us. Now again, I'm not saying that Jesus was just a man, but he bound himself to bound himself to humanity in such a way that he willingly submitted himself to live like we live. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, and acquainted with grief. Some people say, well, God doesn't know what I'm going through. Jesus doesn't understand what it's like to be me. We talked about this briefly in our Sunday school class today. No, Jesus understands exactly what it's like to be you. Jesus knows what it's like to be worse than you. Anybody could come to Jesus and say, do you know what it's like to be me? And Jesus would say, oh, yes, I do. I know what it's like to be hurt. I know what it's like to be rejected. I know what it's like to be betrayed. I know what it's like to be taken advantage of. You fill in the blank, whatever sorrows and griefs and heartaches that you are acquainted with, Jesus Christ is familiar with this. And not just at your level, but at a level that exceeds your wildest imaginations. He was despised and rejected. He's a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. It says here, though, that it goes on. And it actually is more intense. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was somebody that people didn't want to even consider or look at. He was a hated man. You might be asking yourself, why? Well, we're getting there. And we esteemed him not. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. The last couple of words of verse 3. Jesus Christ willingly and humbly submitted himself to the will of the Father for a specific purpose. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8, it says this. Paul writes, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. Listen here. Who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. But he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. That's Philippians chapter 2. Verses 5 through 8. And this is, again, I want to reinforce this to you. This is not Jesus emptying himself of his godness and becoming just another man or just another prophet or just another teacher. This is him willingly submitting to the Father's will. And he is equal to the Father, but he submits himself out of obedience to the plan of God, which he is part of. It gets a little confusing. The Trinity is hard for us to understand. And he takes on the form of human flesh, and he lives a life within the restrictions and the boundaries that you and I call normal. Suddenly, Jesus knows what it's like to stub his toe and to be hungry and to sweat and to bleed and to die. He does this willingly. He humbles himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. This is the first part of the sacrifice, to willingly live a life like this to save his people. You might wonder, what has God done for me? Well, I hope by the end of the sermon you will see just how much God has done for you if you would believe and receive his gift of salvation. So Jesus laid aside his glory for a time. The second thing I want you to know is that Jesus Christ came to carry our sorrows. He came to carry our sorrows. Look at me in verse 4. Surely he has borne our griefs. That word borne means to carry. To absorb, to put it on your shoulder and walk with it. He has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. Such a profound verse. People have such a problem with God. When we share the gospel, which is the good news that Jesus saves, when we share the gospel with people, today most people want nothing to do with Jesus. That's just the honest truth. I don't really want to follow Jesus. I don't want to have to believe what Jesus taught. I don't want to submit to Jesus. That is the heart inside all of us before salvation. I want to be in control of my life. I want to do it my way. I don't want to come under the authority of somebody else. That's who we are, naturally. And so we naturally push Christ away. We say, I don't really want to submit to Jesus. But I have to ask you, why would you not want to submit to Jesus? If you're a thinking and reasoning person, why would you not want to follow the one who has come to bear your grief? Why would you not want to submit to the one who has come to carry your sorrow? It is absolute insanity to reject the gospel. It is. It makes absolutely zero sense to say no to what Jesus has to offer. But sin will make you crazy, won't it? Hard-heartedness will make you crazy. Today, I want you to see that Jesus Christ is worthy of your obedience, worthy of your soul, your life, your devotion. What have you done for me lately? We hear that term thrown around a lot. Jesus Christ has done so much. Anything he did is more than we deserve. He didn't just do one or two things. He did everything. It says here that he bore our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. There were some people who saw what Jesus was doing, and they did not see it as a sacrifice for their sins. They were just saying, that's what a criminal deserves. There were some who looked at Jesus on the cross and said, he's not dying for me. He's dying because he's a rebel. He's dying because he caused an uprising. He's dying because he deserves to die on that cross. There were many who said that then. There are many who say that now. If Jesus did not die for your salvation, if you don't believe that Jesus died in your place, then you have to automatically believe that Jesus did die as a criminal. He did die as a public nuisance. Because either he's a sacrifice, or he's just receiving capital punishment like everybody else did. Which one is it? Sacrifice for your sins, or punishment that he somehow deserved. Why did he have to die? Why did he have to go through this? Why did he have to carry our sorrows? The Bible says in Hebrews 9:22, indeed under the law, almost everything is purified with blood. With blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Jesus had to die because his death is the only thing that can remove sin. The only soap to wash away our guilt is the blood of Jesus. And that's why we preach the gospel. And that's why we're passionate about what he says. Because we all have the same problem. We are sinners. And I think we're all willing to admit that. You're certainly willing to call other people sinners. You yourself are sinners. We all are. I am a sinner. And the only solution to my guilt before God, the only way to have my guilt taken away, is by the blood of Jesus being applied to my heart. And that is the same cure for you. What did he do to make our salvation, our forgiveness possible? Well, let's keep reading. Verse 5, but he was pierced for our transgressions. You know what this is talking about, don't you? When they took the nails and put them through his wrists. They nailed him to a cross. When they put a crown of thorns on his head. And they took a reed, which is like a stick, and they beat it into his brow. And there were holes in his forehead. And holes in his hands and feet. And finally, when they wanted to make sure he was dead, rather than breaking his legs, they took a spear and thrust it into his side. And Jesus Christ was pierced through. But why? Because your sin demands a death. Your sin demands a death. That sounds strong, Pastor. How can you say that? Because the Bible says the wages of sin. And either you're going to die for your sins, an eternal death in hell, or you're going to have Christ stand in your place. You might say, well, how do I know if Christ is in my place? Through faith in him, through trusting him, through surrendering to him. Jesus would say it simply, to turn from your sins and to trust in the gospel. He was pierced for our transgressions. You notice he was not pierced for his transgressions. He had none. Jesus is the only innocent person to ever die. We talk about people, well, they died and they were innocent. Nobody's innocent. You may be innocent of crimes like that, you know. Crimes like we would call them, but before God, none of us are innocent. The only innocent person who ever died was Christ, and he died for non-innocent people, for guilty people. He was pierced for our transgressions. He goes on. He was crushed for our iniquities, for our sinfulness, for the breaking of God's laws. Jesus Christ took our punishment. He was crushed under the weight of the cross. His soul was certainly crushed. His body was afflicted. He was beaten to a point of being unrecognizable by his family and friends. Why? For our iniquities. For our sins. Sometimes we say, sin's not a big deal. Tell Jesus your sin's not a big deal. Tell the one who was beaten. Tell the one who was pierced. Tell the one who died. My sin's not a big deal. Your sin may not be a big deal because you're not receiving the punishment. I was talking to a friend this week and I said, listen, we can either have heaven now and hell later, or we can have a little bit of hell now and have heaven later. And many of us don't realize the severity of sin. I think sin would be less appealing to us if we got the punishment on the front end. It would be interesting if the devil said or if God said, you know, here's this sin. And you can do this, but first take the punishment and then see if you still want to sin. So many of us will turn away from sin quickly. But we think there's not a price for sin. We think that sin's no big deal. But he was pierced and he was crushed because of your sin. It's a big enough deal to hang Jesus on the cross. It is a big deal. Going on into verse 5, the middle. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. He received discipline on our behalf. Not because he had done wrong. Because he suffered vicariously. He took on our punishment. I always use this illustration. You've heard me say it a million times. Growing up, my parents believed in spanking. And they weren't abusive by any means. Don't think I have a complex or something. My parents believed in getting your rear end whooped. And never once did my brother say, "You know what, Mom, I'll take that. Don't spank Jordan. I'll take it." Never once did he do that. And I never did it for him. I never said, "Tell you what, he's innocent. Even if he's not innocent, I'll just take it for him." Never happened. Why? Because I have a brain. I'm not going to do that. That is a very simplistic way of understanding what Jesus did for us. But the problem is that we are supremely guilty. We've broken all of God's laws. And Jesus didn't do anything wrong, ever. And yet he stood and took the punishment. And it's not just a spanking. He died. And he didn't just die a quick death. He died a painful, torturous death. He carried our punishment. We look here at the last part of verse 5, and I'm going to say it to King James, that's how I memorized it, "By his stripes we are healed." You know what the stripes are. And they took that whip, and they tore into him. And they cut him down the sides, and they cut him down the back. Remember, last week, Matt told you about the 39 lashes. You know why they did 39? They thought 40 would kill you. She's given 39. My friends, he was wounded so we could be healed. You look at yourself and you say, "I'm fine." No, you have a mortal wound of sin. You have a wound that's killing you slowly. It is sin nature. It is guilt before God. This is the hope that we need today. 1 Corinthians 15, 3-4, Paul says this, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures." That's the hope today. You say, "I've done so much wrong. I've had so much guilt. I've turned from God. I've mocked God before. I've lived a life that I know God doesn't approve of. How can I find hope? How can I have forgiveness?" And I would say, my friend, if he went through the cross and all the pain and suffering on the cross, what will he not do now? The hard part is done. He's already done the most difficult and most painful part of saving you. Do you think he would withhold giving you what he's already purchased? Would he hold salvation back from you that he's worked so hard and suffered so much to attain? That would be like working 20 years to buy your child a gift and then not wanting to give them the gift after working so hard. What is going to hold him back from saving you? I can think of just one thing, and that would be unbelief. Amen. Pray to God that he would help. Jesus was not just any sacrifice, though. You know, sacrifice is, and that's really no big deal. They've been sacrificing animals a long time. The idea of sacrifice, that was just like the idea of us going to Walmart. Always a sacrifice going on. But Jesus is not any sacrifice. Jesus is the final sacrifice. And he's the final sacrifice because he is the perfect sacrifice. I'm reminded of what John says in John 1:29, the second part of that verse. He says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." In verse 7, we pick up reading, it says, "He was oppressed and he was afflicted," just like any sacrifice.
chance to defend himself, and he didn't. He didn't take it. He opened not his mouth, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth. Jesus willingly was mistried, humanly speaking, because what they charged him of doing, he didn't do. And don't fall into the trap of saying, well, Jesus shouldn't have died. And Jesus, no, he was supposed to die the whole time. But he died at the hands of lawless men. For lawless people. That he will make pure, forgiven, and saved. He was the perfect sacrifice. He did not fight the crucifixion. He did not run from it. He did not try to talk his way out of it. And Isaiah rightfully compares him to a sheep that's led to the slaughter. In verse 8 it says, by oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? Now we're going to touch more on that in a few moments, but the sacrifice of Christ was for his people. Verse 9, they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. They considered him, like we said earlier, a criminal. They treated him unjustly, but it was all according to the plan of God. Which brings me to my next point. Jesus Christ died according to the plan. Can you imagine if we didn't believe that God had a plan? Can you imagine that there is no plan, that God has no plans, he has no agenda, no schedule, and he sends Jesus to the earth, and he says, we'll see what happens next. I don't know if they're going to like him or not, we'll just see what happens. And Jesus grows up to be around the age of 30, and he has a public ministry that lasts somewhere in the neighborhood of three and a half years. And then they decide to crucify him. And those mean people crucify Jesus. And they got him. They should have just left him alone. He wasn't hurting anybody. He wasn't doing anything bad. He was healing people. Those other people, they didn't like Jesus. And so they put him on a cross. And then Jesus died and he came back. And that's the end of the story. That is not the gospel. The gospel goes like this. Jesus Christ came to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. That's what Paul would say. He came here. He ministered according to plan. He lived according to plan. He died according to plan. The only reason Jesus was born was to die. What a sobering thought. He came here. One purpose, to die on the cross. It was not an accident. It was not just a situation gone bad. It was not unforeseen or unplanned for. That's why he came. In fact, Jesus Christ was as good as dead on the cross before the world was ever created. Now that's a challenging thought. That'll give you a headache. Well, let's look at what Scripture says. Verse 10. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. It was the Father who had to have justice. It was the Father who had to have a payment for sin. It's not that the devil had us captive and Jesus had to go pay some ransom for God to get us from the devil. That's a false teaching. The right teaching is this. The Father is a just and fair judge who must punish sin. It's either going to be us being punished for our sins, or Jesus standing in our place. That's the gospel. This is the plan of God. In Acts chapter 2, verse 23 through 24, this Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. You crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. Did you hear that? Jesus Christ was crucified according to the definite plan and the foreknowledge of God. What's foreknowledge? Knowing ahead of time. He died according to plan. In 1 Peter 1:20, it says, He was foreknown before the foundation of the world as Jesus, but was made manifest. That means He appeared in the last times for the sake of you. He came at the right time to die for His people. Before the foundations of the world, Jesus Christ was going to the cross. He died according to the plan of God. What a beautiful thought. Challenging, yes. Friends, there are things in Scripture that you and I will never understand. And that's okay. But there are things that by faith we must affirm. If for no other reason, because the Bible says so. There are many things in the Bible I do not understand. But if it's in this book, I must agree. I must say this is the truth because God's Word says so. If I cannot believe one word of this, I can believe none of it. And the Bible testifies to itself that it is true. It was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Verse 11. Out of the anguish of his soul he shall see, and be satisfied by his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous. Now this is seems like a small detail. It's very important. There is a growing number of people today who believe that we're all going to go to heaven. That we are all going to be saved in the end. It doesn't matter what you believe. It doesn't matter what God you worship. It doesn't matter who you follow. It doesn't even have to be Jesus. You can believe whatever you want to. And God, whoever He is up there, will look on you and say, you tried your best. You can go ahead and come to heaven and be forgiven. And I think that this idea is built on this concept that Jesus died, and so everybody, no matter what you believe, can be saved because Jesus died for everybody. Now hear me closely. What Jesus did on Calvary is enough for everybody in this world to be saved. It is. He died for the world. That means people of every nation, tribe, and tongue, every country, Jew and Gentile alike. But don't you know that not everybody's going to heaven? And so the blood of Christ does not cover those who won't believe. Jesus Christ died for those who would believe. It's a puzzling thought. It's a detail that seems insignificant. I have to believe that Jesus died for particular people. In fact, we're called peculiar people in Scripture. According to the plan of God. My question for you, who did Jesus die for? Based on Scripture, I have to affirm this. Jesus died for the elect. What does that mean? This is the elect. It's those whom He purposed and chose to save from eternity past. Now, why do we have to affirm this, at least in Scripture? It's challenging. It seems to be different than what we thought. Did Jesus die for people who may or may not believe? If Jesus were to die for people who may never believe, that's an uncertain mission. There is failure involved. There is no guarantee anybody would be saved. Matthew 1:21, it says, He will save His people from their sins. John 10:15, I lay down my life for the sheep. Jesus knew who He's dying for. Ephesians 1:4, He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world. Acts 13:48. This one will blow your mind. When the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord, and as many as were appointed to eternal life believed. The idea here is the ones who were believed are the ones that God had appointed to salvation long ago. Now, in case you're getting a headache yet, y'all probably are, because this is the deepest truth of Scripture. The Bible calls these kinds of people two things. The elect or the chosen, and also whosoever will. It's both. We cannot know how free will and how God's sovereign hand work together, but we must believe they are both there and working as God has ordained.
Amen.
Jesus Christ came to die for a people he knew. He did not just die and say, I hope they wind up believing. I hope they get saved. He knew who he was dying for. And that is the truth in Scripture we must understand. It says he will make many to be accounted righteous. Not all. Not everybody is going to be saved. Whoever would trust him will be saved. But the last time I looked around, not many people are doing that nowadays. But God knows. Verse 12, therefore I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Now listen here. Yet he bore the sin of many. It makes intercession for the transgressors. Back in verse 8, the end of it, it says, he was stricken for the transgression of my people. There, the second part, the last part rather, of verse 11, he'll make many to be accounted righteous and bear their iniquities. At the end of verse 12, he bore the sin of many. It makes intercession for the transgressors. The idea here is that Jesus Christ is saving his people. And you might be wondering today, and I hope you're wondering, how do I know if I'm his people? Well, the gate stands open to be his people. He says, repent and believe. If you're not God's people, it's simply because of unbelief. This is something very interesting. I shared this in the Bible conference I was at this past week. I'm going to share it with you. Jesus Christ never requested or asked anybody to follow him. He commanded. He said, come follow me. He said, take up your cross and follow me. He said, repent and believe. He never said, if you're feeling like doing this, if you want to, I'd really like to have you follow me. He never said, you know, I'm kind of nervous to ask you, but I really think it'd be good if you followed me. Would you like to do that? It's almost the idea of when you're nervous and you're about 12 years old and you're telling a girl you like her. That's how I like you. Do you like me? Check yes or no. That is not how Jesus extends the gospel. Jesus commands that we be saved. Because it's serious business. And so therefore, if we do not believe, it's really disobedience to his command.
Amen.
And therefore, whenever we go to hell, if we don't trust him, those who don't, they go to hell, it's because of their disobedience to the command of God to be saved. So I want to tell you this morning, God has commanded you, repent and believe the gospel. Look at this Savior. Look at Jesus Christ who's done so much to pay your way, to take your place, to take on your sin and your punishment. This morning, would you bow your heads for a moment as we begin to conclude the service? Now, I just want to talk to you as if it's one-on-one. We do this every week. Today, I've tried to show you the greatness of Jesus Christ. I hope I've done an okay job. I hope that you have seen how great his sacrifice was. My friends, I hope you're asking yourself why. Why would Jesus do this? The answer is simple. Jesus Christ did all this so you could be forgiven from everything you've ever done wrong and to give you a new heart. You might be thinking, there's no hope for you. But did you know that the Bible says that God will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you and take out your stony and stubborn heart and give you a tender heart that's responsive? The Bible says that. This morning, I hope you're asking yourself how you can get this new heart. I hope you're asking yourself how you can be forgiven. I hope you're asking yourself, how can I be saved? Well, my friends, the price has already been paid. What you must do now is to turn away from your sins, leave that behind, and to trust in what Christ has done. I don't often do this. In fact, I might do this once every couple of years. While our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, and we're not doing this because we're ashamed. We're doing this so we can just concentrate on God and maybe pray for one another. Is there anybody here who does not know if they know Christ or not? If you'd raise your hand, I'd just like to pray for you. Is there anybody here today who is not sure whether or not they're saved or know Christ? And my friends, I want to pray for you. And I want to pray that you would seek the Lord while there's still time. I want to pray that you would understand that Christ alone will save. After the service, after we get done praying here, I'll be here at the front. And I want to talk with you, pray with you if needed. If there's any questions you have about the sermon, anything that you want counseling about or prayer about, this is your invitation. Come and follow Christ. And I want to help you understand the gospel better this morning. Let us close in prayer. Father, we love you and we praise you. We thank you for sending Jesus Christ to be the perfect sacrifice on the cross for our sins. Lord, we know our sin is what put him on the cross. But that, as Colossians say, you nailed to the cross our condemnation, our guilt, the charges that your law had against us, and it stayed there. Lord, if any of us need to be saved, open our hearts to the gospel. Bring faith and repentance into our hearts. Open our eyes to the truth of your word. And Father, for those of us who are following you and who are saved, encourage us by the greatness of the gospel. Encourage us by the extent of love that you've shown us. And as we stumble and fall from time to time, remind us that the price has already been paid for our forgiveness. It's in Jesus' name we pray for his glory. Amen. As I